Hey, good morning, Temple family. Welcome. So glad you're joining us here on this Lord's Day. And welcome to anybody who is watching as well for your first time. We are honored that you are here with us today on this Sunday. One of the things that we would like to ask you to do is, if you like our online service, would you help us out by hitting that like button and also subscribing to our YouTube channel, because that helps us spread the word about this ministry. We like to always begin our service by reading God's Word. And so we're going to be today in Psalm 100. And here's what the Word of God says. Make a joyful noise to the Lord, all the earth. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come into His presence with singing. Know that the Lord, He is God. It is He who made us, and we are His. We are His people and the sheep of His pasture. Enter His gates with thanksgiving and His courts with praise. Give thanks to Him. Bless His name. For the Lord is good. His steadfast love endures forever, and His faithfulness to all generations. Praise the Lord. What a beautiful passage that is. And may that stir our hearts to worship the Lord this day. Join me in prayer at this time. Heavenly Father, thank you so much that as we gather today, we have the confidence of knowing that we belong to you, that you are our Father and we are your children. And we thank you, Lord, that we have a relationship with you through your Son, Jesus Christ, whom you sent as the atoning sacrifice, the Savior, to take away all of our sins. And so for those of us who have made Him our Lord and Savior, this is a blessed day because we are reminded once again of the relationship we have with you and the joy that comes from that. And I pray that in this service, God, that you will renew even in a greater measure our joy and give us grace for life. I pray that you will instruct us today in your word, and that this service will be a blessing to everyone who watches. And Lord, if anyone's watching today and they do not know you, Lord, I pray that this will be the day that they will come to know your Son and the salvation that He brings. And it's in Jesus' name I pray these things. Amen.
Well, good morning, everyone. I'm so glad that we get to worship together this morning. And as we're worshiping together, it's very easy for us in just this Thanksgiving season to be thankful for the Lord and to be thankful for the things that He's done. But then once we get out of Thanksgiving, once we get out of Christmas, oftentimes we kind of refer back to that just, I'm going to wait until I'm at my lower points before I go to the Lord. And so last week in our young adults home group, we were talking about it, and, you know, the question was brought up of, hey, do you go to the Lord more when you're happy, or do you go more to the Lord when you're kind of going through some things in life? And, you know, a lot of us kind of said, you know, it depends, but, you know, there are a few of us who are like, honestly, like, I go to the Lord more when I'm happy. And a few people were like, hey, I go to the Lord more when I'm, you know, going through, you know, anxiety or depression or going through the harder times of my life. And, you know, we kind of came together and saying, hey, we need to hold each other accountable in the fact that when we go to the Lord, it isn't in just the good or just the bad, but in both the good and the bad. Because we realize and we understand the fact that God is the same God in both places. He's in control in both areas of your life. And so this morning, as we're worshiping, I really encourage you, worship the Lord even when it's hard. Worship the Lord even when it's just super easy. Worship the Lord in every moment of your life and really just take hold and lean into the Lord, because every blessing you get is from Him. Every life thing that you go through is a gift from the Lord. And sometimes we don't understand it and sometimes we don't see it that way. But the Lord is there. He's working. He's moving. And so I encourage you in that this morning as we worship together. And I count on one thing, the same God that never fails will not fail me now. You won't fail me now. In the waiting, the same God who's never late is working all things out. You're working all things out. Yes, I will lift you high in the lowest valley. Yes, I will bless your name. Yes, I will sing for joy when my heart is heavy all my days. Yes, I will. And I count on one thing, the same God that never fails will not fail me now. You won't fail me now in the waiting. The same God who's never late is working all things out. You're working all things out. Yes, I will lift you high in the lowest valley. Yes, I will bless your name. Oh, yes, I will sing for joy when my heart is heavy all my days. Yes, I will for all my days. Yes, I will, and I choose to praise, to glorify the name of all names. That nothing can stand against, I choose to praise, to glorify the name of all names. That nothing can stand against. Oh, yes, I will lift you high in the lowest valley. Yes, I will bless your name. Oh, yes, I will sing for joy when my heart is heavy all my days. Yes, I will for all my days. Yes, I will for all my days. Yes, I will.
Well, I want to always say thank you for your giving. Each week I try to say that, and it's not just perfunctory on my part. I really genuinely mean it. Your giving does make a difference here at Temple Baptist Church and beyond with the ministries that we support. And so thank you so much for what you do. I always love to give us a Bible verse or a giving principle just to remind us that this is what we do with our money is much more profound than just kind of throwing money in a plate or sending in a gift online or something like that. It is an actual gift, an act of worship. And so today, just to remind you, a verse from the book of James. James says, every good and perfect gift comes down from our Father of lights. Think about that. Every good and perfect gift in your life, where does it come from? It comes from God. It comes from His hands. You can be confident if anything good in your life that you have, it has definitely come from your Father in heaven. So today as you give, remember that. Remember that all the blessings that God has placed in your life, and remember to be a blessing to others. You can give a number of different ways in our church. You can mail in your gifts to our church. You can come drive by and drop them off in our drop box if you're out and about. You can set up recurring giving at templechurch.net. And you can also do text to give, where you text the number 84321 and any amount to that number, and your giving will be counted for this church and the ministries that we support. Again, thank you so much for all that you do, and let's pray together. Father, we thank you, God, for your many blessings in our lives. And God, we come to you today once again to show you how grateful we are, how we recognize that every good thing comes from your hands. So we lay these gifts at your feet, and we pray that you help use them to advance your kingdom on earth. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Hey, everybody. Just want to talk to you real briefly about our upcoming Christmas Eve service at 6 p.m. We're super excited about this. After going through last year's COVID and now coming through it, we're just hoping and praying for an amazing service, well attended. We've been, praise the Lord, seeing how people are coming back little by little every week. So December 24th, 6 p.m., We've got some special things planned for you. One of those involves kids. You want to talk about that, Matt?
Yeah, we can't wait. Nathan's been working with our Temple kids for quite some time. They're going to be singing some special music for you that night, so come out, join us, sing along with them. But I know they're super excited. I know our mock students are excited to be there as well. So we hope you'll join us again the 24th of December at 6 p.m. for our Christmas Eve service.
And let me give you this one challenge. Find one person that you can bring to that service that night, just one person that you know hasn't been to church in a while, or maybe doesn't have, as best you know, a personal relationship with Christ. Invite them to our Christmas Eve service. We hope to see you and your friends on that night. God bless you.
Hello, everyone. I'd like to invite you to the Merry Little Christmas Party. It's going to happen on December the 5th at 6 p.m. We're going to have cookie decorations. We're going to have ugly sweaters. We're going to have music and tons of fellowship. You should come out and spend some time with us because Jesus would want you to.
Hey guys, my name is Kimmy. I have an announcement for you this morning. So Monday, November 29th at 10 a.m., we're decorating the sanctuary for Christmas. So come out and join us. Everyone is welcome. And we'd love to have you guys come out and help. It'll be a great time. If you have any questions, just contact the church office. All right, thanks guys.
Merry Christmas. Well, almost. Hey everyone, we want to invite you guys out to our Christmas Eve service that is on Friday the 24th. It's going to start at 6 p.m. It's just going to be a great way for us to come together and really learn more about our Savior and just praise Him during this Christmas season. One thing we want to do is we want you guys to invite your friends, invite your family out to church that night. Just find one person, like Wes said last week, that you can invite out to church. And so if you look on the front of your pews, or downstairs by the giving boxes up on the windows, you'll see these cards, right? And so we want you to take one of these cards, give them to your friend, give them to a family member, and invite them to come out that Christmas Eve. And so we are really looking forward to that night. We're looking forward to, you know, worshiping our Savior, learning more about Him, and just coming together in the Christmas season to focus on Christ. So we hope to see you guys there. That's at 6 o'clock on Friday, December 24th.
Parents, aren't you tired of not having a break? Don't you wish that for 1 hour you could have some time off? Well, I do too.
It's okay, buddy. I have just the thing for you. And I'll even give you a bonus hour. For 2 whole hours, you can bring your kids to church. For Parents Night Out, December the 10th, or Pizza Palooza. From 6 to 8 p.m., go get some shopping done, have dinner with your wife. A bonus hour just for you, Gustavo. There you go.
That sounds fantastic!
Well, got a little bit of a surprise for you today. We're going to take a break from the Book of Revelation. In fact, we're not going to come back to the Book of Revelation until we get in the new year. We've got, if you've been keeping count, one chapter left. We'll be in chapter 22 starting in the new year. So today we have a guest speaker, and then next week we're going to be starting a Christmas series. But what I want to do today is tell you a little bit about our guest speaker. If you'd have asked me maybe 20 years ago who my heroes are in the faith, I would have probably pointed out a number of big name preachers, probably some of whom that you like as well. And I would have said, these are the men that I admire. But as I have lived and ministered over the years as a pastor and as a Christian, the people that I look up to, that I admire, that I respect in the ministry are not big name preachers that you see on TV and that you buy their books in the bookstore, although those are, I'm sure, really good men. The pastors that I love and I really respect are the ones that I know up close and personal. And so when it comes to being a pastor, typically those are the people I like to bring in as well to speak at our church. And so let me tell you a little bit about the man who's going to be speaking today. His name is Pastor Chris McMillan. He is a senior pastor at Providence Baptist Church. He has served there for the past several years. And recently, the Lord has called him into a new ministry. And so he is going to be stepping away in the new year and starting a brand new ministry. And the name of his ministry that he will be leading is called International Training and Equipping Ministries International. So basically what he's going to be doing is training pastors all over the world. And so it's a super exciting ministry. You're going to love this brother. He is quite the preacher of God's word. He's a great man of God, has a beautiful family. And so Chris is going to come and give us the word this morning. I hope it's a blessing in your life. In fact, I know it will be. And I know you're going to love this brother as much as I do. God bless you.
Well, good morning, Temple. So good to be with you this morning by way of video. What an honor and joy it is for me to be able to share God's word with you this week. I trust that you have had a wonderful Thanksgiving and that you are looking forward to a great Christmas season as well. So this morning I'm excited to bring a message to you out of the Gospel of Luke chapter 10. So if you have your copy of God's word with you, would you please turn with me to the Gospel of Luke chapter 10. And our text comes to us this morning, verses 1 through 9. I'm reading this morning from the ESV, the English Standard Version. So let's read together again, Gospel of Luke chapter 10, beginning in verse 1. And after this, the Lord appointed 72 others and sent them on ahead of him 2 by 2 into every town and place where he himself was about to go. And he said to them, "The harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. Therefore, pray earnestly to the Lord of the harvest to send out laborers into his harvest. Go your way. Behold, I am sending you out as lambs in the midst of wolves. Carry no money bag, no knapsack, no sandals, and greet no one on the road. Whatever house you enter, first say, 'Peace be to this house.' And if a son of peace is there, your peace will rest upon him. But if not, it will return to you. And remain in the same house, eating and drinking what they provide, for the laborer deserves his wages. Do not go from house to house. Whenever you enter a town and they receive you, eat what is set before you. Heal the sick in it and say to them, 'The kingdom of God has come near to you.'" This is God's word to us this morning. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for the power of your word. Holy Spirit, would you come this morning and do what only you can do? Would you awaken our hearts so that we might desire you? Would you open our eyes that we might see wonderful things in your law? Would you open our ears that we might hear what the Spirit says to the church? And we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, I want to share with you this morning a message I've entitled Living on Mission. I recently read about an inner city church that was located in an area of the downtown in which was very sparsely populated. A large corporation had offered to buy the church facility because they wanted to place a parking lot there. However, there were many people in that particular church who didn't like the idea of selling the church and moving to another area in the inner city that was much more populated, where they would have a greater opportunity to minister to more people. And the reason that they resisted selling the building is simply because they had been there so long, and the building had been there so long, they pointed out that the church's architecture and history was traced all the way back to the early 19th century. Great denominational history had been made in that church. The church's greatest figures had passed through their portals. And so all of these things mitigated against them selling the church. However, the pastor began to talk about the need for moving and the need to be able to reach more people. Ultimately, the church decided to sell the building, and they moved to a brand new location in a teeming inner city neighborhood. And when asked about this process of leading the church from one location to another, the pastor said that we had to decide whether we wanted to be a museum or on mission. In other words, if we were going to be a museum, it meant staying in the past where we were and glorying in the things that the church had accomplished and being essentially guardians of the tradition. And we would remain there and we would serve a few people, but we wanted to be able to reach more people and we wanted to move forward. And so we gave up what we had achieved throughout the years in order to reach more people by moving to this new area. We opted for mission over being a museum. And I think that's a great illustration for us this morning in understanding where we are as a church in Newport News, but also this is a primary issue that churches are facing all across America with the decline of spirituality and the decline of religion in American culture, is that do we want to be a museum or do we want to be on mission? If we opt for museum status, then we're going to cease to be a New Testament church, because at the very heart of what it means to be a New Testament church is mission. In fact, someone said it this way: church exists for mission as fire exists for burning. And we have to ask ourselves this question: are we protecting our turf? Do we think that that's our main goal of being in existence as a church? In other words, is our existence here in Newport News merely to be the guardians of some tradition that's been handed down to us, some religious tradition? Is our goal, is our responsibility to be the tradition of a building because it has a certain architecture or because certain denominational history has been made in this place? So are we protecting turf or are we ready to take new ground? And as we come to our text this morning, we are in a very strategic portion of Luke's gospel. Luke has divided his gospel essentially into three parts. In chapters 1 through 9, Luke gives us the birth narrative of Jesus and then his Galilean ministry. And in chapter 9, verse 51, Jesus turns his face toward Jerusalem, and for the next 10 chapters from that point until chapter 19, it would describe Jesus' journey toward Jerusalem to his appointment with his crucifixion and ultimate resurrection. And then chapters 19 through 24 would describe the passion narrative of Jesus. But chapter 10 really is important because Jesus has just turned his face toward Jerusalem. He has just sent out the 12 apostles on a mission, and here he sends out 72 others of his disciples on a mission to proclaim the triumph of God's unstoppable kingdom. And the big idea from our text this morning is simply this, is that because Christ sends us out on mission, then we should joyfully embrace his call to proclaim the gospel to Newport News and beyond. And so I want to share with you this morning from our text several imperatives that are essential for us in embracing our mission to Newport News and beyond. And here's the first one. If we're going to embrace our mission, then we must participate in the mission. I want you to look with me, if you will, at verse 1. And it says, "After this, the Lord appointed 72 others and sent them on ahead of him, two by two, into every town and place where he himself was about to go." Now, it's interesting that Jesus says here that there were 72 others. Now, again, I already mentioned that previously Jesus had sent out the 12 apostles on a very similar mission. And the idea here that Jesus sent speaks of the authority that Jesus has. Remember that when Jesus was raised from the dead, the very last words that he spoke to his disciples, we often call the Great Commission, is prefaced in Matthew 28, 19 and 20, verses 19 and 20, with these words, "And I have been given all authority. All authority on heaven and earth has been given unto me." So when Jesus sends, he sends by his authority. And it's interesting that Jesus sends his disciples to do something. He sends them to go and tell. He sends them to go and proclaim. Unfortunately, we've gotten the idea in many of our churches that the whole idea of evangelism is for people to come and see. Think about the various things that we do in our communities to try to reach people. And primarily, it takes place on church grounds. It takes place on the church campus. It's because we've become so accustomed to wanting people to come to us instead of thus go to them. And so Jesus doesn't call sinners to come to us. How many of you understand that sinners are oriented, their hearts are oriented not toward the things of God, but to run away from God, to hide from God? So sinners aren't going to come breaking down our doors wanting to come into the church. Our job as the Church of Jesus Christ is not to tell people to come and see, but to go and tell. So there's an inversion that needs to take place in our own thinking, in our own attitudes. There's a paradigm shift that must occur. And it's interesting because Jesus says that Luke tells us that Jesus sent out 72 of his disciples. Now again, these are not the apostles who had previously been sent out. These are 72 others. Now, there's been a raging debate among scholars upon whether this is really 70 or 72. I'm going to go with the ESV translation of 72. But that's not the main point. The reason that this figure is mentioned, whether it be 70 or 72, goes all the way back to Genesis chapters 10 and 11. And you may remember what's happening there in Genesis 10 and 11. In Genesis 11, we have the culmination of man's rebellion against God, in which he seeks to build a tower that will reach to heaven. Ultimately, the intention of sinful man in building that tower to heaven was to locate the deity. In other words, that's how ancient peoples controlled their deities. They wanted to control God. They wanted to make a god after their own liking, after their own making. And so God confused the languages of the world, and of course they were dispersed. The tower was left unfinished. But what's interesting is what prefaces chapter 11, which is Genesis chapter 10. And there we have a list of all the nations that participated in building the Tower of Babel in Genesis 11. And notice how many nations are mentioned in Genesis chapter 10. There are 70 nations that are mentioned. So here, when Jesus sends out his disciples, his 72 disciples, essentially the call is to go and reclaim the nations that were dispersed in Genesis chapters 10 and 11. In other words, the call for us as the church is to go and reclaim what God has made new. And that's the great news of the gospel. The good news of the gospel is that Jesus is at the center of history, making all things new. God has a great reclamation project that he wants to accomplish in the Hampton Roads area. And that reclamation project is the redemption of people who have been bought by the blood of Jesus Christ. You know, we live in a time when reclamation projects, when refurbishing furniture is a whole industry. In fact, not long ago, there was a reality show that was actually made about remaking and refinishing and refurbishing furniture. It's big business. And it should be something that is significant for us, an emphasis for us in the church as well, that God is calling us to reclaim the nations. God is calling us to reclaim lost souls for the sake of his kingdom. But we also see something here that is important. We see that missions is not just for a select few. In other words, Luke tells us that Jesus sent 72 others. The 12 apostles were in a class by themselves. They were uniquely called and anointed by God for a specific purpose. And they were sent out on a mission. But do you know who else Jesus sent out on a mission? 72 others. This tells us that we have been given the responsibility to be missionaries in whatever station of life that God has called us. In other words, all of us are charged with a mission to reclaim the nations. Understand this morning, that missions is not a program. Missions is not a breakfast that we have when it's time to have the Lottie Moon offering emphasis. Missions is the very reason for our being. It is the reason for our existence. All of us have been charged with the responsibility to go and to be a missionary. The great Prince of Preachers, Charles Spurgeon, said it this way: every Christian is either a missionary or an imposter. Several years ago, the International Mission Board had an emphasis. It was called Limitless Pathways to Missions. And what this simply meant is that they were seeking a way to release, not inhibit, missions so that more people could participate. And this involved not just having those that we might think of traditionally in the missions role as preachers and teachers, but having everyday, ordinary people who have different skills to go to foreign lands, foreign cities, live and perform whatever skill, that gift that God has given them, whatever trade that they have learned. Maybe it's opening a coffee shop, maybe it's being an engineer, but to use those gifts and talents as a means of cross-cultural ministry. So we're living in a day and age in which we must think differently about how we're going to reach the nations. But we must always remember that all of us have been given a role to play, and all of us are responsible in that role if missions is going to take the priority in our local church. I want you to notice something else here as well. Jesus sent them on ahead of him, he says, two by two into every town and place where he himself was to go. Notice that Jesus didn't send them into the far-flung corners of the earth yet. That was to come later. But here he sends them locally. He sends them into the places that he is getting ready to go into. It tells us that missions begins in our own backyard. Sometimes we can see missions again as the purview of professionals who are gifted in such a way and given the responsibility to go and to live in some foreign place that we'll never go to and to do cross-cultural ministry there, when actually missions begins right here in our backyard. Missions begins right here on Harpersville Road. Missions begins right here in Newport News in the Hampton Road area. Again, when Jesus told his church in Acts chapter 1, verse 8, when the Spirit comes upon you, you will be witnesses unto me in Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and to the uttermost parts of the earth. Notice the progression there. Jesus said it's going to begin right here in your backyard, and it's going to progress until it goes around the world. And so often what we have happening in our churches is that we have many churches that give toward missions around the world, but do very little in their own backyards to reach the people that God has put them to reach. Now think about it this way, that every church has been placed in a community providentially by God so that they might be beacons of hope to that community, so that they might reclaim lost people in that community for the glory of Christ. And so, we should give toward missions. Yes, we should send missionaries. Yes, we should be greatly concerned and invest in reaching the 95% of the world's population that lives outside the borders of the United States. But that does not give us a pass on ignoring those folks that live around us in our neighborhoods. There are broken people right here in Newport News. There are people in need of the gospel right here in Newport News. And God has placed Temple Baptist Church here in this community for such a time as this, so that we might stay on mission, so that we might reclaim the nations that are right here. See also that Jesus sent them out two by two. He sent them out two by two for a practical reason and a theological reason. Theological reason is because in Deuteronomy 19:15, it says that everything is established in the mouth of two witnesses. So this was a way that Jesus confirmed the truth of the gospel. But in practically speaking, it also provided accountability and encouragement for the two who were to go out. And it also tells us that we are not lone rangers in this Christian faith, that God does not call us to go out and do our own thing, that we need others, that we're responsible to others, we're accountable to others in the body of Christ, and that together we can do more than we can by ourselves. We live in a culture that seeks to have its own designer religion. We want to be able to do our own thing without anybody else telling us what to do, without any accountability. That is not the faith that the New Testament portrays of the biblical Christian. The fact is that we are accountable to others. The fact is that we do need others. We don't have the kind of requisite gifts that we need in order to do everything that God has commanded us to do as part of the church. We need others. And to be on mission means that we are a part of something. We are a part of a whole that is greater than just the individual role that we play in it. So I want to encourage you this morning to think about your participation in the mission of God. Right here in this community, what am I doing where that I am participating in reclaiming the nations right here in Newport News? Am I a part of the solution or am I a part of the problem? Has my love for Christ and evangelism grown cold or is it burning white hot? Do I long to share the gospel in whatever way the Lord puts in front of me? Or do I feel like, well, it's no use. People are going to do their own thing. We're living in a time when everybody has rejected Christ. So what's the purpose? Or, you know, I'm just too tired to do that. I don't have the bandwidth to do that. I want to encourage you this morning that God is calling you to participate in the mission. But secondly, Jesus tells us here that we should pray for the mission. Look at verse 2, and he said to them, "The harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few." Now that's an important statement. Remember that in Jesus' days, a very agrarian culture, and so that when the harvest came, the harvest had to be harvested quickly or that the crops would rot in the field. And so Jesus says, it is the harvest time. It's a great harvest time. In Jesus' incarnation, God began His process of reclaiming the nations, and it is harvest time. So we have been in harvest time for the last 2,000 years. And so Jesus says the issue is not that there aren't people to be reached. That's not the issue. The issue is that the laborers are few. As we look around our own mission field right here in Newport News, it's not that there is a lack of people to be reached, is that the Christian laborers to reach those folks are few. And let's extrapolate this. Let's expand that a little bit and think about beyond Newport News and beyond Hampton Roads to the world that we live in. Do you realize that there are about a little over 11,000 unique people groups in the world in which we live? Well over half of those people groups that are defined by their tribal ethnicities and identities, well over half of them, over 6,000 have never heard the gospel of Jesus Christ. They are unreached people groups. And according to the Center for World Missions, an unreached people group is a people group or an ethnicity or a tribal people that have less than 2% of their population that are even what we might call evangelical Christians. In other words, there are too few Christians in that people group in order to plant churches and to perpetuate the gospel to reach that whole people group. So over 6,000 of those in the world. That's over 3 billion people. Now, I want you to think about this number for a minute. Let's say that we were to line everyone in this congregation up this morning. If we were to start lining people up from the main sanctuary, from the pulpit, and we were to line them up one by one without any space in between, that line, and we were to say that this line was the line of lost people in the world, that line would stretch out of the back of the sanctuary temple, out of the parking lot, down Harpersville Road, down to the bridge. And if we could build a bridge and cross the river and get to the Atlantic Ocean, and we would build a bridge and cross the Atlantic Ocean, that line of people would stretch across Europe. It would stretch across Asia. It would circle back around 37 times. Think about that for a minute. That is the daunting challenge that you and I face this morning. That is the great mission that Christ has given His church. That there are billions of people who have never heard the gospel of Jesus Christ. 155,000 people dying every day without hearing that there is salvation in Jesus Christ. Right here in our own community, 90% of people do not attend any kind of a local church, which pretty much means that they are either they grew up Christian or they're not Christian anymore or are just pagan. So think about this. We have hundreds of churches in Newport News, hundreds of churches in the Hampton Roads area, and yet 90% of the community remains unreached. Friends, that should not be. But the fact is that we have few laborers and many pretenders. We have plenty of excuses as to why we can't be on mission. We don't have time. We don't have energy. The demand is great and the earthly rewards are few. Again, I want to refer to something that Charles Spurgeon said. He said this, "Will the heathen who have never heard the gospel be saved?" Oh, it's more a question with me of whether we who have heard the gospel and fail to give it to those who have not can be saved. When I first heard that quote, it stunned me because I realized in many ways that my priorities were out of order. And so also God is calling us to reorder our priorities because the laborers are few. I'm reminded of that great scene in Isaiah chapter 6 in the year that King Uzziah died. And Isaiah saw the Lord high and lifted up, sitting upon His glorious throne. And Isaiah was so terrified by the vision of God's holiness that he says, "I am ruined." And in the Hebrew, that's an idiom that means I'm coming apart. And in other words, I'm fearing so in encountering God's holiness. And in that moment, an angel flew from the altar and took his tongs and took a coal from the altar and cleansed Isaiah's lips and cleansed him from his sin. And notice what Isaiah's immediate response was once he was cleansed from his sin. He just simply said, he heard the voice coming from the altar saying, "Who will go for us?" And Isaiah said, "Here am I. I will go." And that is the rightful response of every believer to God's call. I will go. Who will go for us? Here am I. I will go. So the harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. What do we do about it? So Jesus tells us this is how we respond. We pray earnestly to the Lord of the harvest that He would send out laborers into the harvest field. Prayer is the key. Now I know that this sounds like Sunday School 101, right? To pray. But it's interesting, the word prayer here in the Greek is a word that literally means to plead or to beg. It speaks of intensity in prayer. And I believe that we can pray, and then there are seasons that we pray. You probably understand the difference between the two. And there are many churches that pray, but there aren't many churches that pray. And God is calling us not just to pray, God is calling us to pray, to plead, to beg, to earnestly ask the Lord to raise up laborers, to quicken our hearts, to awaken our attention, to give us a love for the lost, to give us a love for these unreached people groups, to pray as if there is no tomorrow so that there might be an urgency in our own heart, an urgency in our own mission efforts, an urgency in our own preaching, like we are dying men preaching to dying people. This is the call that God has placed upon His church, that we must pray. I know as a pastor that leading people to pray is one of the most difficult tasks that we have because people generally don't want to pray. I mean, let's be honest. If we have a church dinner, we'll have hundreds of people show up to a church dinner or a barbecue or a spaghetti, something or other. But if we have a prayer service, you have about 5 or 10 people that are going to show up. And they're the same faithful people that show up to pretty much everything. And it shows us where our heart is as the people of God. And yet prayer is the hinge that turns the doors in the kingdom of God and opens to us all of the treasures of His kingdom. It is possessed through prayer. The promises are possessed through faith and prayer. Everything that God has for us is given to us because we pray and we ask, and we have not because we ask not. And so Jesus tells us here that the answer to our problem in missions, it's not that there aren't people to be reached. It's the fact that we've not prayed ourselves hot enough so that we might participate in the mission that God has given us. Friends, I want to encourage you. Let's start praying once again. You know, there was a time in the history of the church when Wednesday nights used to be called the Wednesday night prayer meeting. Why? Because churches gave special emphasis to prayer. Even our prayer on Sundays many times is really perfunctory, right? We come into church and as pastor, we do our pastoral prayer, but we want to make sure that we keep it short and sweet so that people are following along with us and that we're paying attention. And it's almost as if in many ways, prayer is just an afterthought. Prayer is something peripheral that we do in our time together of corporate worship, when in fact, if we read the New Testament, especially passages like 1 Timothy chapter 2, that prayer is at the core of who we are when we come together, that the main thing that we should be doing is praying together. Could it be that the reason that our churches have no power? Could it be the reason that our churches are declining? Could it be the reason that our churches are rife with strife and discouragement and decline is because the church has neglected to pray? Could it be the reason we're not reaching people is because we're not praying them in? Folks, God is calling us to pray. And then notice what Luke tells us here, or Jesus says here. He says, pray earnestly to the Lord of the harvest. Jesus refers to Himself as the Lord of the harvest. In other words, He wants us to know that salvation is of the Lord. Salvation doesn't come from people. We can't save ourselves. He is the Lord of the harvest. Ultimately, Christ is responsible from moving in the hearts of unregenerate men, and the Holy Spirit regenerates them through the preaching of the gospel. So that's good news and encouragement for me because it means I don't have to save anyone. My role is to be a faithful witness, and as I witness of Christ, then the Holy Spirit does the work that only He can do. The Holy Spirit quickens that word and regenerates and brings to life. But it is the Lord who is the Lord of the harvest. He is the one who determines how fruitful the soil is and the conditions that make the soil fruitful. He is the one who ultimately decides whether the fruit that we bear is 30, 60, or 100-fold. And so we pray because we recognize that ultimately He is the Lord of the harvest. So we participate in the mission, we pray for the mission, and then thirdly, Jesus tells us to prepare for the mission. Look at verse 3, if you will. And Jesus says, go your way. Behold, I'm sending you out as lambs in the midst of wolves. Here Jesus lets His disciples know that the mission is dangerous, that persecution, harassment, martyrdom are real possibilities. Again, we go back to Acts 1:8. After the Holy Spirit has come upon you, you shall be witnesses unto Me. That word in the Greek, witness, literally is where we get our English word martyr. And many of those early disciples, those early apostles were in fact put to death. But I believe that there is a great application for us here. And it is so important for us, especially in the age in which we live. It is this idea of safety. We have almost idolized safety to a point where that's the most important thing for us. And we've especially seen this in this coronavirus pandemic. I believe that there are some people who just want to perpetuate this thing for forever because their main goal out of life is just to make sure that we are safe in everything that we do, to try to deter any kind of or minimize any kind of risk that would be out there whatsoever. However, we see here that if we're going to be on mission, that the mission is dangerous. Jesus says, I'm not sending you out into a safe world. I'm not sending you out into safety. I'm sending you out as lambs in the midst of wolves. And if you know anything about the animal kingdom, you know that lambs are easy prey for wolves. Wolves come in and tear them apart. And so it is, Jesus says, I'm sending you out as prey among predators. Now, that doesn't sound safe to me. You may not know this, but I heard this recently from a missionary from the International Mission Board, that when on September the 11th, 2001, when those planes hit the World Trade Center in New York and they fell, and of course the chaos that ensued, that there were parents and family members of missionaries who were overseas that were demanding that the International Mission Board bring their children home, bring their family members home, because it was unsafe. Now, I want you to think just for a moment about the incongruency of that statement. They have gone out on the mission field. Already, it was unsafe, but because of this particular event that happened, all the families woke up in a moment and said, oh, this is unsafe. They need to come home. And friends, that is the thrust. That is kind of the thinking. That is the paradigm of the modern evangelical church, is that we have to be comfortable. We have to be safe. We can't send our kids to the mission field. We can't encourage them to go and follow God's will, because it might interrupt kind of like the comfort of their life. It might interrupt like the safety of their life. They might not be safe. I don't want to send my, you know, adolescent, my teenager on a missions trip, especially if it's to a place that's not safe. Can I tell you, friends, and I'm not saying that we should just abandon all logic and abandon, you know, all risk. What I'm saying is that if we're serious about following the Lord, it's going to entail risk. There is no risk-free strategy when we give ourselves wholeheartedly to the mission, because Jesus sends us out as lambs among wolves. Jesus said, if the world hates me, it's going to hate you. And the world has already hated me. That's why it hates you. If you were like the world would love you, but you're not. You call the world, you call out its sins, therefore it hates you just as it hated me. We needn't expect, as disciples of Jesus Christ, that people are going to throw a parade for us. We're not going to win the key to the city. We're going to be hated. We're going to be despised. We're going to be lambasted. We're going to be mocked. We're going to be ridiculed, because this is a fool's gospel. And that's what Paul said in 1 Corinthians chapter 1, that the wisdom of the cross is foolishness to those that are perishing, but to us who believe, it is the wisdom and the power of God. Friends, can I tell you this morning, we need to put away our idol of safety. We need to put away our idol of comfort. And we need to recognize that in giving our lives to Christ, we are laying everything down for the sake of His glory. That we're laying everything down because we have found the pearl of great price. We have found the one for whom our soul was created. We have found the one, the great treasure that nothing else can ever compare to. And He is worth everything. He is worth giving our life for. He is worth serving. He is worth going to the far-flung corners of the earth and suffering if we need to, only for a moment in this brief glimpse of time that we have on this earth, so that we might gain Christ forever. Prepare for the mission. Then fourthly, Jesus tells them to prioritize the mission in verses 4 through 8. Notice what he says, carry no money bag, no knapsack, no sandals, and greet no one on the road. It's important here because there are several principles that Jesus is giving us. First of all, he's stressing the importance of his provision and depending upon him, that we go out with empty hands and full hearts. Notice again, he tells the disciples, don't carry any money with you. Why? Because the workman is worthy of his wages. Don't worry about how your provision is going to come, but just go and provision will be given you. Let me give you the wrong question to ask when we think about how we're going to reach our community. The wrong question to ask always is, how much will it cost? Why is that the wrong question? Because rarely does God give us provision up front. Usually provision comes as we go. And that's an important thing for us to consider. There are many churches that are struggling this morning, maybe even in our own community, and they have a whole community around them that is lost and dying, and they might want to reach out, but they say, we can't afford it. That's not the right question. It's not the right attitude. You can't not afford it. The question is not, can we afford it? The question is, when we do this, we know that God will provide. That is the attitude that we need to have as we move forward to reach our communities. But it also tells us something else. It tells us that God has already laid it upon the heart of people to provide for His workmen. So wherever we go, whatever we do, God has already put it upon the heart of someone to provide. It is our responsibility, and that's the implication of what Jesus is saying here, that as these disciples went into these towns and communities and they went into a house, that it would be incumbent, because of ancient Jewish and ancient Near Eastern cultural hospitality practices, for them to take care of the needs of those who came to them. And so it is that we as Christians have a responsibility to our Great Commission workers to provide for their needs. That's why Jesus says the worker, the laborer, is worthy of his wages. He deserves his wages. Did you know that only about 2% of the average Christian's income is given to the Lord's work? That's right. Not 10%. We often hear about the tithe, but we're a long way from 10%. The average Christian gives about 2% of his income to the Lord's work. Even more stunning was a statistic that I read not long ago that said this, that Americans give twice as much. Christians, evangelical Christians, are included in this number. That Americans give twice as much, spend twice as much on Halloween costumes for their pets as they do on the Great Commission. I want you to think about that for a moment. Over $1.2 billion was spent in 2019 on Halloween costumes for people's pets. A little over $400 million was spent on Great Commission causes. We need a reorientation of our heart. We have to prioritize the mission. And one of the ways we prioritize the mission is by prioritizing it financially. Love what the great founder of the China Inland Mission, Hudson Taylor, said. He said, God's work done in God's way will never lack God's supply. So not only do we see here that God promises His provision, but also Jesus encourages them to recognize the urgency of their mission. Notice what he says, greet no one on the road. Oriental greetings involve gesticulations and all kind of elaborate handshakes, and it normally took quite a bit of time. And so Jesus says, I don't want you to go through all that rigmarole, all right? What you have a job to do, it is urgent, so I want you to get busy in doing it. And that is God's message to the church today. You have a job to do, it is urgent. Now it's time for you to get busy and doing it. Don't spend a lot of sideways energy focused on a lot of other things. No, as Carl Henry's once said, the gospel is only good news if it gets there in time. Listen, church, it is time for us to get busy. I know that COVID has kind of put all of us to sleep in some ways. It's kind of lulled us into this spiritual apathy, and that so many of our churches, people who were attending and members, have not come back yet, and we're trying to get into new habits because we formed old habits now. But now the season, the time is urgent. It's time for us to move forward in the purposes of God. We need to recenter the mission again so that we don't become a museum. It is urgent. The time is now. It's time for us to get busy. Notice also that Jesus tells us here, as we think about prioritizing the mission, that comfort is not a consideration. Notice what he says in verse 5. Whatever house you enter, first say peace to this house. If the Son of Peace is there, your peace will rest on him. But if not, it will return to you. And remain in the same house, eating and drinking whatever they provide. What is the message Jesus is getting across here? Listen, when you go into a house, don't leave because it's not comfortable. Don't leave because they're not serving the kind of meat that you want. Don't leave because the surroundings or the accommodations aren't what you're accustomed to or are not to your liking. No, stay there. In other words, the mission is not about you being comfortable. If there's one thing that kills our mission in our churches, is our comfortability. Well, for some reason, we've gotten the idea that everything has to be comfortable. But since when is denying yourself and picking up your cross and taking it to the place of execution? Since when is that comfortable? It's never been comfortable. It never will be comfortable for disciples of Jesus Christ. And our mission will not be comfortable because it is always stretching us. It is always calling us to live out of faith. It is always putting us in opposition with the hostility of the world. It is always calling us to take new ground. So no, comfort is not even a consideration if we're serious about our mission. I have to remind myself of this often when I go to various places around the world where there are conditions that are not quite what I'm accustomed to at home, where there are hard beds and no electricity and no ice, where I can't find a Coke Zero. And I remind myself often in those times, God has not called me to comfort, even though I like to complain. God has not called me to comfort. He's called me to obedience. The mission is not comfortable, but I must be obedient. Finally, number 5, Jesus commands us to proclaim the mission. Notice what he says here, verse 9. Heal the sick in it and say to them, the kingdom of God has come near to you. Jesus tells us to heal and to proclaim. Why this idea of healing? Because in the Old Testament, one of the signs, the marks of the coming Messiah would be that he would heal the sick, that the lame would leap as a deer, that the deaf would hear and the blind would see. And so Jesus' ministry was focused not just on teaching, but on miraculous acts of power, such as healing the sick. But notice that he extends this authority. He extends this power not only to the 12 apostles, but also to his 72 other disciples. And he says, go and heal the sick. In other words, what Jesus is telling them, and this is the application for us, what Jesus is telling them is to go and make visible what is invisible. The kingdom is present in Jesus. The kingdom is invisible. We live in an invisible kingdom. Jesus is reigning at the right hand of God. His reign is not visible yet, but through the power of the kingdom that works in the church, we make that which is invisible visible. In other words, there is this tension between the already and the not yet. The already is that the kingdom has come and been inaugurated in Christ. He has ascended and passed into the heavens where He sits at the right hand of God. But yet, not yet do we see the fruition, the fullness of that reign of the kingdom of God. That will only come at the second coming of Christ. So in the meantime, we are seeking as the church to make the powers of the kingdom that are invisible, visible. And we do that through our good works. We do that through our behavior. We do that through our Christian ethics. We make the good news of the gospel palatable. We make it visible. We announce and proclaim the glory of Christ. And that's what the gospel is. The gospel is an announcement that things have changed. The gospel is an announcement that Christ, the promised one, has entered into history and is making all things new. The gospel is the announcement that we are sinners, that we are separated from God by our sin, that we need a Savior. The gospel is an announcement that we can't do anything to save ourselves. Our name on a membership list will not save us. Giving money in the offering plate will not save us. Because grandma was a Christian will not save us. We are in need of a Savior. The gospel is an announcement that Christ has come for sinners like you. And all we need to do is repent, place our faith in Christ, and then old things will pass away and all things will become new. Friends, can I tell you this morning as we bring this message to a close that God has called us to participate in His mission. He's called us to prepare for the mission, to prioritize the mission. He's called us to proclaim the mission. And this question again, I ask you, one final time. At Temple, will we become a museum or will we be a mission that God is using in a great way in our community and around the world? Let's opt that we might be on mission this morning. Can we pray? Father, thank You for our time together today. I pray, Lord, that You would grip our hearts with the urgency of Your mission. God, that You would strengthen us. Lord, that our comfort, that our safety would not be inhibitions to what You want to do in this community of faith. Lord, give us the faith, the strength, the resources, everything that's needed to reach others for the sake of Your kingdom. We ask it all in Your precious name. Amen. May the Lord bless you.
Well, let's come together now as a body of believers and let's close out our worship together by singing songs.
Worthy is the Lamb, worthy is the Lamb.
are you, Lord God Almighty? Worthy is the Lamb. Worthy is the Lamb. You are holy. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. For the Lord God Almighty reigns. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Lord God Almighty reigns. Hallelujah. Holy, holy are you, Lord God Almighty. Worthy is the Lamb. Worthy is the Lamb, you are holy, holy. Are you Lord God Almighty? Worthy is the Lamb, worthy is the Lamb, you are holy.
Well, I want to thank you today for tuning in, and I hope that our service today has been a blessing in your life. I hope you enjoyed Chris's message. In fact, I know you did. This Sunday is the beginning of Advent, and so let me just give a little plug that if you can join us in person, we'd love to have you at our church this coming next Sunday. Join us for this Christmas season. It's just a beautiful time to gather together. Our attendance has continued to peak up, praise the Lord, and so we're super excited about that. But we miss you. We miss those of you who watch online, and we know why many of you are not with us in attendance. We just want you to know we haven't forgotten you. We love you. We hope the Lord will quicken the day that you'll be able to be back with us in person. Until that day, we're going to continue doing what we do here, and we hope it's a blessing in your life. And again, if it is, help us out by spreading the word. And you can do that by liking and subscribing, leaving a comment on our YouTube channel. Subscribe to our channel. That makes a huge difference. Thank you again. God bless you, and we'll see you next week.